At WrestleMania 40, we saw Cody Rhodes finish the story. That was the big sort of meme amongst the WWE fanbase. Cody was repeatedly being told to finish the story. There was a lot of emphasis put on the idea that Cody was putting an end to a long-running story, and in many ways he was. I mean, there's the obvious story he's finishing, his own story, poor gimmicks and mid-card jiggery-pokery, slowly paying his dues and working for years, even founding the bloody competition in his time away from WWE. He came back, came so close and was screwed out of it, then finally brought it all to an end at WrestleMania, falling the Tribal Chief after one of the longest title reigns in WWE history. But was that the only story that he was finishing? Of course not. Upon returning to the WWE, Cody and the announcers and commentators would make reference to Dusty being screwed out of the WWE Championship years ago. But what actually happened? Was Dusty supposed to be WWE Champion? Here's the crack. To say Dusty Rhodes was a big star in the territory days would be a massive understatement. Dusty was a hell of a draw, and alongside this was a hell of a booker. He made the quote, "Dusty finish, an iconic part of wrestling." Now, many people know that Eddie Graham is really the man who invented the concept of a Dusty finish. But Dusty Rhodes took the concept and ran far with it, including it in many of his matches. See, a Dusty finish is where one wrestler, usually the babyface, appears to have won the match, but the decision is reversed, usually due to a small technicality. You may wonder why I bring up what a Dusty finish is. It's because the story that Cody finished started with a Dusty finish. Dusty had endeared himself through the early 70s to the wrestling fanbase at the time, partly due to his innate charisma and, dare I say it, flair, but also partly due to his relatability. Wrestling fans would see this working class, man of the people with a physique that resembled an overweight fan more than it resembled a professional wrestler, and would live vicariously through this hero that was before them. Having worked multiple territories and captured both fans and wrestling personalities alike with his unique charm and gift of the gab, Dusty Rhodes found himself in the WWE in 1977. However, back then the WWE was known as the WWWF and was helmed by Vince McMahon Sr. It was during this first on and off run with the WWWF that Dusty Rhodes would challenge superstar Billy Graham for the WWWF Championship in Madison Square Garden. Some people may think that the reason Dusty was never allowed to run with the championship was due to animosity that the WWE has shown Dusty Rhodes for generations. However, this predates that animosity. At the time, Dusty had not run competition as a booker. He was yet to be the booker for the NWA, and he hadn't done really anything to get under the skin of WWE management. As far as Vince Sr. was concerned, Dusty Rhodes was merely a charismatic talent with a lot of potential. Dusty wrestling for WWE, which is a New York territory, took Dusty out of his comfort zone. New York was not where Dusty had made his name, previously having mostly made his name in the Texas and Kansas territories, as well as his time in Florida. There was a chance the New York fans wouldn't have understood the American dream. However, they immediately reacted positively to him. And so did a certain Vince McMahon Jr., who was on commentary. It's also worth noting that this MSG encounter, which took place on September 26, 1977, was not Dusty's first attempt at the big one. He had already challenged for the WWE title four times before this, and between August 1977 and January 1978, Dusty Rhodes had competed for the championship 11 times. He won 10 of the 11 attempts at the belt. All of his wins were situations in which the title can't change hands due to a technicality. This is why it became known as the Dusty finish. I mean, bloody hell, we thought we had it bad with predictable bloodline finishes, but 10 technicalities keeping you from the belt in like a year or so is crazy. It's funny that they never talk about the other 10 times Dusty competed for the belt, but it makes sense, as it's not really as good of a story then. Every match Dusty had during this time for the belt was against superstar Billy Graham, since they were both absolute thunder on the microphone. The reason the fans were so ready to see Dusty win is because at that point Billy Graham was the most hated WWE champion the company had had up until that era. Traditionally, the WWE would reserve long title reigns for their babyfaces. For example, Bruno Sammartino, who would hold the belt for years at a time, only dropping it to a heel for short breaks. Billy Graham was the first heel champion to hold the belt for a prolonged period of time. Imagine how you felt about Roman pre-Mania 40. This rather poetically mirrors how fans may have felt regarding Billy Graham at this time. Except kayfabe was a little better protected, so they probably wanted to literally kill him. Visually, the difference between Dusty Rhodes and Billy Graham could not be more apparent. Where Graham was a muscle-bound, juiced-up, and clearly arrogant meathead, Dusty Rhodes was a round, belly-bouncing man of the people. Dusty, however, wasn't as large as he would become. But the fans were definitely ready to see a man they felt they could relate to on such a level, overcome the odds and defeat this intimidating bulldozer of muscle. But that wasn't to be the case. Throughout the match, Graham and Dusty do some old-school wrestling. Billy Graham was demonstrating his immense power. Dusty was demonstrating a surprising level of speed. During the match, Graham would slowly walk out of the ring and attempt to leave the match entirely. Generating a lovely bit of heat from the crowd, he would return to the ring and fake like he wanted a handshake from Dusty. Dusty refused the shake because Dusty ain't no fool. During the scrap, Dusty ends up backdropping Billy Graham over the top and outside to the floor, where the referee goes outside to check on Graham. The referee decides to count the finish outside the ring, which at the time was a bit of a bizarre decision as referees would usually count in the ring. This could potentially have exposed the intended count-out finish, thereby exposing the business. The referee reaches a 10 count, and Dusty Rhodes has won the match, at which point Dusty grabs the championship belt as the fans go absolutely wild. New York has just seen the big, bad, evil Billy Graham get toppled by the endearing and charismatic man of the people, and they all lived happily ever after. Or so you thought. Dusty and the fans are informed that the title cannot change hands over a count out. And just like that, we begin the story. Dusty Rhodes had been robbed of a belt that the fans felt was rightly his. Dusty would only wrestle on and off for the WWE at this time, and therefore was never given the belt. Dusty would go away from the WWE and do territories as well as become the booker for the NWA. However, this long term may not have helped Dusty with regards to his standing with the WWE. At the time Dusty was NWA booker, they were running competition against the WWF, which at the time sort of had beef with the NWA. It was over championships and Rogers and Thez and all sorts of history. I can cover the whole beef in another video, but long story short, Dusty Rhodes would return in 1989 to a very different WWF, now under the control of Vince McMahon Jr., who was unimpressed with physiques that didn't fit his certain sourced up standard. It was very unlikely that Dusty was going to be taken seriously in this run, and oh no, surprise, surprise, they've put him in polka dots. Dusty's second run with the WWE was littered with attempted humiliation. They put him in polka dots and made him do these weird common man vignettes, which were intended to humiliate Rhodes.
I'm the pizza man. Oh yeah, let me see here. Let me see now. We got that, a sardine pizza.
But Dusty, being Dusty, leaned into these vignettes and made it work.
I'm gonna show you my patented trash man Americana hookshot.
So now when you look back at how much Cody put his heart and soul into the admittedly bad Stardust character, you know where he got it from. Stardust was Cody's polka dots.
About here is very simple. Doo-doo is good for me.
That's why this story has been so compelling to hardcore wrestling fans who know a bit about the history. The WWE has seemingly had beef with the Rhodes family for quite a while. Whether you think the Goldust character was a part of this is up to you. Whether you think these decisions and gimmicks came from malice is also up to you. The fact remains that the Rhodes family, despite their capabilities in wrestling, have always been given comedy gimmicks or bizarre gimmicks during their runs with the WWE. Dusty, of course, would reintegrate himself with the WWE in the late 2000s. During this time, he was signed with a Legends deal, and they made DVD documentaries about his legacy. Clearly, the animosity was starting to wear off around this time. Dusty would spend time training NXT superstars, creating the next generation of talent, and spilling his wisdom to those lucky few who got to train with him. So that's what the real story was. Years of a family not being given the respect they deserve in gimmicks and characters and opportunities in the WWE. Finally, their youngest son, the Chosen One, the American Nightmare, finishes the story his father never could. That is very impressive. To have such a long and compelling story that stretches all the way back to the 70s finally get its climax. Finally, a Rhodes would topple a heel who had held onto the title for too long, overcoming every barrier put before him and his family for generations. Badass, in my opinion. Thanks for watching once again. I've been Sarcastic Mark. Hope you're enjoying these deep dive history videos. Be sure to check out my video about Lou Thesz if you haven't already, and subscribe if you're into wrestling history, because wrestling history is a sarcastic Mark's bread and butter. Thanks, bye.